Hi guys, welcome back to the Let's Play. Let's get Chapter 1 started.
Previously during the investigation.
These puppies are making me go to another town in the boondocks again.
I didn't think you'd keep me waiting in the rain for so long.
Welcome to Greenwood.
I'm Sheriff George Woodman. Call me George.
There's definitely something in this town. Do you feel it, Zach? My coffee warned me about it.
I feel it, York. I'm excited.
It's broken. I've been using that one for a long time.
Why didn't you get it repaired? This TV is important to you, right?
Why don't you get a flat screen?
It's got some memories attached to it, sure. I used to watch movies on this thing with your grandma all the time.
Grandma likes movies?
Of course she did. Everyone loves movies, right?
I love movies too. I've never been to a movie theater though.
Okay, kid. So, all the scenes with the little girl and her grandfather are new additions to the director's cut. According to the game's PR, these scenes are supposed to help answer lingering questions and provide a deeper understanding of the storyline for players. Like how Grandma likes movies, it's totally relevant to the murder investigation. It was revealed during the press tour from Sweary that they had actually received complaints that the original game was just too hard to understand and follow, especially since the game started in such a bizarre way with the York and the Twin Angels in the Red Room. This player confusion was apparently the reason Sweary wrote these new scenes, hoping that they would help ease players through the strange murder investigation. But I gotta say, these complaints are quite unfair. Yes, the game is bizarre, but it certainly isn't difficult to follow and understand if you pay attention. Even if there's still some mysteries left unexplained, Deadly Premonition does explain a lot of the madness. Players just need to give it a chance to unfold. So I kinda wonder if player confusion was just an excuse, because the importance and impact of these new cutscenes were way oversold during the director's cut promotion. Outside of the additional epilogue, moments between the girl and her grandfather are just kind of inane filler. They don't add much explanation of anything to the overall story.
York! York!
Hey there, random kid. What's up? Okay, we're just gonna stare at each other. This is a little kind of awkward. Oh, great, one of the limbo people.
Don't breathe. Hold your breath. They can't see you if you hold your breath. Hurry, like this. Cover your mouth.
So this section is just trying to teach you about the breathing mechanic. In the game, if York holds his breath because the shadows are blind and they can't hear him breathing, they won't be able to see him and attack. Though this mechanic isn't very useful, I find, because when York is holding his breath, he does this like crab walk thing and moves really slowly past the shadows. We'll also be using a lot when we run into the raincoat killer. When York needs to hide, he'll end up having to hold his breath, and if he doesn't keep his breath held, the raincoat killer will find him. Though, I honestly don't understand. I mean, the shadow is right up next to them. You'd think he'd still feel their presence next to him, even though they're blind. But I think this section is actually the longest York holds his breath in the game. As you'll see, he can't hold it for very long.
Who are you?
I'm not gonna tell you. Okay. I'm gonna show you now what happens if you don't hold down the right trigger button and York lets out a breath. He dies! Very dramatically. It just sent you back to the main red room, and you repeat the whole cinematic again. That is a huge bed. So apparently York sleeps with his clothes on. He doesn't have pajamas.
The symbolism in my dreams continues to intensify. A forest of red trees. A carpet with red leaves. A strange doll. And twin angels. But that child is what bothers me the most. I swear I've seen him before. I just can't remember where. Well, it'll probably come back to me eventually.
Wait, you just lit that. You just lit that cigarette.
Coffee.
Why are you putting it out? Why even bother lighting it up if you're just going to put it out within 2 seconds?
Let's head to the cafeteria, Zach. I hope they have some real coffee.
Cigarettes are expensive,
York. I really need some coffee. Then we can head to the sheriff's office.
We'll find out soon enough.
There's a proper procedure for everything, right, Zach?
Sure is. So, this picture above York's hotel bed is supposed to be of Greenvale's Velvet Falls, which we will visit later in the game, but it is totally a photo of the real Snoqualmie Falls and Salus Lodge and Spa up in Washington State. The falls and the lodge were used as the location of the Great Northern Hotel in the 90s television show Twin Peaks, which Swery often denies, whenever asked, as being a major influence for Deadly Premonition. Even though Swery denies it, anyone who has watched the show can see the similarities between the two, and like this photo here, there's other photographic references to Twin Peaks within the game. But I should point out, Swery and his development team did visit California, Oregon, and Washington for research, and they took tons of photos to help create Greenvale. You can even see a picture they took of the Snoqualmie Falls among the coverage photos in the Deadly Premonition special menu, unlocked once the game has been completed. Over here is York's suitcase. During the investigation, York will acquire a variety of suits. There's 10 suits available in the core game, with 6 more add-on suits available through the Director's Cut DLC. These new suits can only be enabled one at a time through the game's start menu and will take the place of the Workaholic suit when enabled. They have special attributes that can increase York's tolerance to hunger, tiredness, his attack power, hit points, and even his monetary rewards when they are worn. These suits have to be purchased if you play the Director's Cut on PlayStation 3, but they are all included when you buy the PC port. I won't be really using the DLC suits during my playthrough, but I do plan on making a separate video to show off all the available Director's Cut costume and vehicle DLC a little bit later down the road. So the reason why York has such a varied wardrobe is because his suit will actually become dirty during the investigation. If you don't take the time to change into a new clean suit, York will be penalized for being a stinky agent and even accumulate a number of huge flies. The longer a filthy suit is worn, the number of flies that circle York will increase. But there's no other adverse effects. I mean, none of the other characters will ever comment on his stinkiness, but the huge flies can be kind of distracting during cutscenes. Every day York changes into a new clean suit, the Bureau awards him a monetary bonus for being fashionable, so it's also good for your wallet to take the time to change suits at least once a day. Once you change into a new suit, make sure to send the dirty suit to the dry cleaners, since very dirty suits can take up to 24 in-game hours to be cleaned. Speaking of which, Swery has mentioned in several Director's Cut interviews that he originally wanted York to also have the option to use a perfume if he was unable to send a suit to the cleaners, which would mask the smell and prevent the flies, but this idea, along with playable eating scenes, sadly ended up on the cutting room floor during game development. Though thinking about it, I think Febreze probably would have been more appropriate for York to use than perfume. Looks comfortable enough, though I'm starting to miss my own bed back home. You can't actually sleep at this point because the game wants you to head over to the cafeteria for the coffee, and you have to make it there by 9:50, or the game will automatically start the cutscene. We got some time, though. It's only a little after 7. Over here on the TV, we're gonna get our first sweary sighting. There he is, skydiving! He appears several times in the game. I believe he's on the TV, he's on the trading card, he's on a poster, and of course his name is used for the name of one of the bars in Greenvale. And these TVs, they just sort of kind of cycle through a couple images. But what I kind of like about it is, in certain residences, the TV images will be different. But in general, it's usually sweary skydiving and the logs and the people talking at a table. I don't really need to save, but Almost Antique feels good to take a break once in a while from civilization. Yeah, you have to, because you let your laptop die in the rain in your crash, so he's regulated to this typewriter. You'll actually get to see him use it in a cutscene in the future. Okay, we got some patio doors. They actually lead to the back of the hotel with the lake, but we can't actually go through them right now because the game wants us to head over to the cafeteria. Yeah, Naked Lady. This hotel has some interesting artwork on the walls. We're gonna see several ladies in the nude on the walls here. Over in this mirror with the razor icon, York has the option to shave. If you do not shave York regularly, he'll actually grow a little beard. It's not necessary to keep a clean-shaven appearance, but the Bureau will send money at least once a day if York shaves. But other than shaving, there's not much else we can do in the bathroom. But there might have been if some of Sweary's original specs for the game weren't scrapped during development. Originally, Sweary planned for York to be able to take showers and even have the ability to change his hairstyle during the game. These were cut for time and money reasons, but during development, he even entertained the idea of making, I guess, a sort of minigame out of grooming York. He thought it would have been quote-unquote fun for the players to control a brush and wash a naked York and use a hairdryer on his head. But he thought these moments turned out kind of lame, so he cut them from the game. And over to the side, York has a little cooking nook, a little stove. What's this? Real estate flyers, random pictures of berries, and of course over here is our toolbox. Alright, let's get out of here and go to the cafeteria. See, another naked lady. Photos of celebrities who stayed at this hotel, from the president to rock superstars. Check this out! Isn't this your favorite cartoon director right here? Must be an honor for you to be staying in the same hotel. Sure is. I always thought the blurry photo in the middle looked similar to the end photograph from The Shining, but I figured I was just seeing things. I mean, it's just a blurry black and white group photo. But recently, this was brought up by Mr. Windup Bird on the Deadly Premonition Reddit page, and they were pretty insistent that it was actually the same photo. So it made me take a second look to compare, and I have to agree, it looks like Access Games just cropped the Shining end photo and plopped it on here. Rooms along the corridor, exhibit on deer, dining room in the center with a view of the lake. So it's a floor plan of the hotel. I just kind of want to point out, it's kind of a neat detail, but all of the clocks in Daily Premonition will show the in-game time. So it's 7:18. And it's 7:18 on the clock. I just thought that was a kind of a neat detail that all the clocks work. And over here we got some vending machines. Various kind of food stuff. Some of my favorites though. Alright, what do they got for sale? Lollipops and crackers. And Jesus Christ. Almighty. These are very expensive. 4 crackers, nearly $36. Five lollipops for like $25. Alright. Wow, coffee isn't any better. Coffee milk, $13.50. $31.50 for coffee black. You would think that coffee black would actually be cheaper. It's just black coffee. The other one has milk. So, yeah, prices in Greenville are kind of insane. It's a good thing York makes so much money daily. When Surrey was asked about this, he laughingly explained that normal common sense doesn't apply in Greenville. There's no cell phones. Everything closes down when it rains. Popular shows don't play on the TV, and the flies are huge. So, insane prices, too.
Good morning, Mr. Morgan. Your breakfast is ready for you.
Hi, Polly.
Thank you, Mrs.
Polly Oxford. Just Polly is fine.
Well then. Thank you, Polly. I'm starving.
Is everything all right, Mr. Morgan?
Yes. It's delicious, Polly. My compliments to the chef.
I'm hoping my cooking will bring back repeat guests. Honestly, though, it's been a while since anyone has stayed here.
I couldn't help but notice. Aside from you and me, there seems to be no other guests or workers around.
What's that? The salt's in that white shaker there.
Thank you. I was wondering if there were any other guests or workers here.
Oh, no, no one else. My husband and I used to run this place, but he's in heaven now.
You've been working here alone since then. Must be hard by yourself.
Oh my, we're all out of pepper. I'm very sorry.
It must be difficult to run a hotel by yourself.
Well, yes, I suppose. I could just live on my pension, but I have to admit, running a hotel is kind of like a hobby of mine.
That's nice. Polly, it might help to hear you better if you could sit a little closer.
Oh my, Mr. Morgan, you're embarrassing me. So early in the day, too. I think I'm a little too old for you.
And I still...
She always thinks he's hitting on her.
May God rest his soul. I appreciate the invitation, but I'm fine over here.
Polly, I can hardly hear you from all the way over there.
You're exaggerating.
All the whistles. It's hard to hear you.
It will do to be all clumped together with such a large table and cafeteria. We have to make use of all this space.
Now tell me, that wound on your face, what happened?
Let's just say I had some trouble during the last case I was working on. I'm sure it'll heal. It's just
it's like he's yelling over the music.
Well, there's no need to be the tough guy here. I want you to be able to relax here. I've prepared a special room for you. A famous rock star once stayed in the same room, you know.
Who?
Really?
Who was it?
I feel honored.
If you need give us a name. Anything at all, just let me know. I'll help you out in any way I can.
Zach, the lady is offering to help. Do you want to ask her about the town?
Sure. Let's do it.
Say, Polly, what can you tell me about this town?
Well, let me see. You might know this already, but the town is called Greenvale. It rains here quite often, but it's a nice place, surrounded with nature. It was a big and prospering lumber town until not so long ago. We used to have a population of over 6,000.
Kinda hard to hear you, Polly.
Less than a
the music's drowning you out.
This hotel was built back then. We saw plenty of guests in those days.
That's why this place is so big for such a small community.
I
have so many fond memories from back then. I suppose the clock on the community center is quite famous, too.
The clock?
Oh, yes, it's lovely. It rings in the morning and at night to let the whole town know the time. You'll hear it many times during your stay. It's a beautiful sound. And you'll love it, too, I think.
I look forward to hearing it, then.
Anything else you'd like to know about?
Shops.
Yes, actually, Polly. Could you tell me about the shops around here?
Shops? Well, there aren't many. It is a small town, after all. You can do most of your shopping at the Milk Barn convenience store. The couple who run it are a unique pair. I'm sure you'll get to like them. The A&G Diner is a great place to eat. They might be open even if my kitchen is closed. If you want to go to a bar, there are two. The Galaxy of Terror and the Sweary 65. I don't care much for either of them.
Interesting names.
Bars are for the younger folk. We also have a gas stand, of course, the art gallery, and even a gunsmith. You should be able to find what you need.
Thank you, Polly.
Well, Mr. Morgan, I'd better start cleaning up. You just take it easy. I'll bring your coffee out in a moment.
Thank you, Polly. I have to warn you, though. I am very particular about my coffee. The very best you have, please.
I understand. I'll be right back with it.
Did you see that, Zach? Clear as a crisp spring morning. F.K. In the coffee. I knew I could count on it. Never fails.
Such a creepy smile.
Now, let's get going.
So that window is showing the backyard of the hotel. The double doors on either side of the room actually lead to the backyard, but they're not letting us go through because they want us to go through the front doors to end the chapter. I love the camo carpet. It's an interesting interior design choice, Polly. Naked ladies on the wall, camo on the floor. Now, I just want to point out, it's just York and Polly in the hotel. Check out the spread she's made for him. It's so much food. Potatoes. I think watermelon. Nothing noteworthy on the menus with the hotel being this big. Not worried about the quality of food, but I opt for junk food any day. Right, Zach? Man, just... yeah. Is that donuts? Pizza? Bread? Pasta? What's over here? I don't know, like little desserts maybe? Like cinnabuns? Quiche? I don't know. Salad maybe? Salad bar? What? Wait, what is that? What is that? Is it like a lobster or like a crustacean of some kind? What is that? All right, coffee. And water, is that soda? Have some fantastic coffee and find out what your fortune is for today. Sounds good, let's do it.
There's always trouble heading my way in this job. But I'm always up for a little excitement, too.
Okay, let's do it again. So each time you have a cup of coffee in the hotel dining room, you're given the option to divine a fortune. But these fortunes have little to do with your current progress in the game.
There's no theme park in this town, though. All that good luck is just slipping away.
Well, that's too bad.
But I think I'll have a thrilling enough time right here anyway.
Okay, that's enough. There's a total of 16 possible fortunes, and you can learn York's lucky or unlucky colors, items, places for the day, and York will always make some sort of response. You can divine his fortunes as many times as you wish in one sitting, but we're not going to do that. We got some exploring to do. Alright, let's check out the map. This is probably the best view of the Greenville map you're ever going to get in the game. And I say that because the map is really crap. So, this is as far as you can zoom out. Yeah, you can zoom in, but you can only zoom out so much. It's one of the things I wondered why they didn't fix in the director's cut. It's one of the biggest complaints of the game is the map wasn't usable. Simple guide to Greenville, overview of the shops in the town. AG Diner, turkey sandwiches, milk barn, convenience store with rock and roll music. Enjoy your evenings at Galaxy of Terror. That's Story 65. Those names, seriously. If you didn't listen to Polly, you're probably like, what the hell is Galaxy of Terror? Is that like a haunted house? So let's go upstairs. It's a little museum of sorts of a Greenville industry. Blade of a huge saw is on display, likely used ages ago. But you might think it'd be about logging, but it's mainly about the deer hunting up here. Tells us here that deer hunters score points according to the number of antlers on their prey. If all the culprits we caught had antlers, what would our score be by now? I don't know. How many have you caught, York? It's getting me all nostalgic. What's in there? I see a newspaper clipping. Some books. Okay. Deer hunting was popular in this town. This article says one family had their 6-year-old daughter practice shooting with pig's heads as targets. Better watch out for the hunting aficionados among the ladies here. Oh, wow, and there is a little girl with a huge-ass shotgun. Those look like normal-sized pigs, not just the heads, though. I could say that many schools closed down on the opening day of the hunting season, so many kids would skip school. They decided to make it official. Maybe we should think about taking the day off ourselves on opening day. That's kind of funny. I think a lot of people want to do that with the Super Bowl here, since so many people take it off. Old tools used long ago for lumber milling. Not that I know what they're for, though. A saw. And I think we can hazard a guess, York. They're used for chopping down trees. Controversy, cruelty of shooting game for entertainment. Deer hunting helps keep the deer population in check, thus maintaining balanced ecosystem. Could homicides be? I wonder. That's kind of morbid. Deer hunting season opens. Greenville, known for its love of hunting, practically allows hunting all year round, though the type of prey depends on the season. Bears, turkeys, pheasants, crows, ducks, wild ducks, geese, rabbits, among them. What's the difference between ducks and wild ducks? But actually, you don't really see that many animals around Greenville. Deer? Is that a... I think that's a typo. There's only... You see horses, you see squirrels, dogs, birds, deer, and that's about it. Okay. Glories of days long past showcased in a small package. Maybe this was the extent of their glory. And it's the same clipping and books. Okay. Display shows Greenville official hunting rules. Don't shoot females. Males scored according to the number of antlers. Various clauses on deer hunting. If they shot us by accident, do you think they'll stuff us as rare specimens? I hope not. That's kind of gross. Alright, this doesn't seem to be any value. What do you think, Zach? Well, I thought you'd have a comment. You've commented on all the other ones. There's some books. right, last thing. Deer hunters don't shoot the does. Figured all the ladies deserve special attention. And that's it for up here. And over here, we can check the weather. Today's a fine, clear day, perfect day to have a walk. This is actually useful because there's certain side missions and whatnot, you need a certain weather condition. So if you're trying to get that, you can always check the TV and it will give you what the weather will be like for that in-game day. An egg in the microwave. Hey, Polly's on the move. Hey, Polly. Shelves are lined with various goods. Their selection isn't exactly remarkable, but we may still find something of interest. What does she have here? You got cookies, cigarettes, cola, candy. What's up on the top? Is that spam? It is spam, but it's called meat. I think that's my favorite. Cake mix, canned goods. All right, what do we got over here? Photo in front of the clock tower, I think. All right, let's go talk to Polly. Hey, Polly, what are you doing? You knitting? That's good. Oh, no, I want to talk to you. Don't leave.
Oh, hi.
Yeah, so there's not going to be voice acting all the time. Most of these optional conversations are going to be in text form. I'm not going to even try to give them voices. I'm just going to let you guys read them. Polly's having none of your death wishes, York. She's always misunderstanding him. Always thinks he's hitting on her. Alright, one more time.
Oh, hi.
You can always tell when a character has more to say because the talk option is in yellow. Alright,
oh,
so
hi.
Yeah, we want to shop. Let's buy from Polly. And wow, her prices are pretty bad too. Let's get some coffee. Oh, Jesus. 4 crackers are $20 from her. A donut is $20. Just one donut. I'm gonna get another. Oh, I forgot I got a donut in the red room. Cheese. $22.50. It's not even like a full wheel of cheese. It's like a quarter. Such a ripoff. I think that's the worst. 6 worms for $119. Go dig them up outside. And a rod, $125. Wow. It's only about like $7 more than the actual bait. We're gonna use that to go fishing in the back of the hotel and get a trading card. It's like a fishing mini game. It's not actually too fun. None of them really appeal to me. All up for junk food and coffee anytime. You keep saying that. I understand you like junk food. But what about Zack? What is Zack like? Maybe Zack is more of a connoisseur. You know, he wants more of a gourmet meal. One of the bottles has Polly written on it. It's not like she needs to keep the bottle. All right, let's see what she has here. We got yourself, liquor, dry, sweet, is that dark beer? Yeah, sweet sake. What's over here? Fruit. Just fruit. Oh, okay. Not too impressed by your alcohol selection there, Polly, but oh well. Ladies' room, off limits, even if it's empty. And it's not a real door, so we can't go in there anyways. Men's room. Not much we can do in here except shave. Okay. It's locked. This room is actually going to be occupied by another character we're going to meet a little bit down the road. More fake doors. Wait, what does that say? Please make up room. So this is sort of the economic side of the hotel. The rooms are smaller, as you can see here. And not as lavish, I guess. No rock stars staying here. Oh, whoops. Alright, let's put in the jewel box. Yeah, but York can actually sleep in pretty much any bed in the hotel. He doesn't have to sleep in his room. A small bathroom. Alright, we got another exit over there, and over here, think about the lumber mill. They have a timeline of events, but frankly, I'd rather read something I'm interested in. Well, excuse me, York. What is that? Tracks? A house? Oh, what's this? Are they Dutch? Are those wooden shoes? Clogs? Naked lady. Exit. There's not anything in that room. Start out chopping trees with axes, using rivers to float them down. Which reminds me, this town does have a riverside. Last room, I think, has a flare. Yep. Yep. Alright. Says they use teams of cows to move the lumber down to the river. Figures we human use whatever we can lay our hands on. Puts ham on future. Is that what it says? Puts ham on future. Okay. Alright, there's nothing else down this section, so let's explore the other end of the hotel. Over here are some payphones if you wish to pay to save your game, but you should always go to your hotel room. I like the little out of order sign. Oh, they got little notepads, and pens, and ink. Very old fashioned. Right, so. One. since the steam engine was invented, they modernized the system and carried logs and lumber by locomotive. I recall there being some dead tracks near this town. We're starting to repeat pictures here. Oh, nothing over here. So over here is pretty much a copy of York's hotel room. It's, of course, missing, you know, the suitcase and the toolbox. But it does have a box of stabilizers in the shower. Save us some, $185? Instead of buying from Polly. Right. It's important to protect the forests in Greenville and maintain its beauty. Okay. That's it for lumber mill related stuff. That goes to this side parking lot. This is more like Polly's personal quarters. We got her little garden right here. Indoor garden, likely one of Polly's hobbies. She must have had the room renovated for this. Yeah, lots of plants. Cactus, ferns. I haven't seen this plant anywhere else in town. Is it me, or was this one supposed to be extinct? Oh, it says the same thing. I thought maybe it might have said something different. We got a easy on a red. Another exit to the back of the hotel. And over here, we have Polly's private dining area. And a can of pickles. Which we can have our next conversation inside. She'll be making her lunch. But it won't happen until around 12:30. So we're gonna move time forward by smoking a cigarette. There we go. So yeah, you can see Polly make her lunch. Hey, Polly.
Oh, hi.
I don't know. I don't see what you're making. Yeah, so she'll putz around the kitchen, and when she's done with her lunch, she'll put it on the little cart and cart it over to the table and sit down to eat. And a lot of times, she'll, later on, she'll have guests over during lunch and dinner. And you'll see her eating with them. I wonder if... Ooh. I see what you mean. It doesn't seem to be loading right now. Usually you see a plate or a cutting board and whatnot, what she's doing, but it doesn't seem to be loading correctly right now. Alright, last room here is Polly's bedroom. Not really much we can do in here. Another naked lady. But... Whoa. Party hard, Polly. Three glasses there. We'll actually have a little side mission. I'll have to grab something from her room. But I just thought I'd show it off. There's not much to see. Just books. Alright. So, the next new conversation we can have with Polly isn't until dinner time. So, to move time forward a little faster than a cigarette, we're going to take a nap. So, let's go in this room. Six hours?
Yeah.
Nope. You can hear the clock. So Polly's doesn't start making dinner until after 8. So we'll have to smoke another cigarette when we get there. I'm gonna try to do kinda late. Maybe we can get her at the table instead of just making her dinner. Nope. Hey, Polly.
Oh, hi.
We got a stew going, I think. Is that what she's making? Oh. Ah. Didn't load again. She's cut into air. Okay. Maybe I can move time forward just a little bit and she'll be sitting at the table. Might be too late. No, she's still cooking. Oh, but she's not going to her cart. I don't think she's gonna sit at the table. Polly, come on. It figures. When I want to record this, it doesn't happen. Oh, wait. Oh, she's moved to the table. Maybe it will show it. Guess not. Nope, okay. Yeah, it's too late. She usually heads back over to the lobby around 2045. Because she needs to be behind the counter by 2100. to have our next conversation. So the game gives her time to travel there.
It's a shame.
Okay. Okay, this is the last conversation we can have during this chapter with Polly.
Oh, hi.
How what looks. What are you talking about? Oh well. Well, there's nothing else we can really do in here, so let's leave. And end chapter one. Yay! So, thanks for watching. Next time we'll begin chapter two. It should be a rather long video, because I'm going to do a lot of procrastinating, talking to people, and exploring Greenvale. Should be a lot of fun. I hope you'll join me. Bye!